the basic message about this is that this is available globally and with high resolution. So this has to compare to the global data sets that were not developed for the wind industry. They were developed for many different purposes in environmental management, but not for wind resource estimate. And they have a lot of errors. The global data sets are not validated locally. That means that there are errors in the land cover classes, which could translate into errors in the wind resource modeling. So another product that we have looked at is the land trend and forecast analysis. This is extremely relevant in sites where you see that there are lots of changes going on. All over the world, there are lots of land changes happening. That can be deforestation, it can be urban buildup that could affect both historically how the site was performing in terms of wind profiles, but also forecasting what is expected to happen in that particular site that you're looking at. So what we can do with this, with historical satellite images, because we actually have satellite images that go back to 95, to 85 and even earlier, is that we can analyze those images and see when was the forest cut, what has happened over time, and what do we expect happened at a certain site in the years to come. We can also look at where the deforestation has taken place and analyze how the regrowth of that forest is happening in terms of assessing what kind of forest is it, what is the expected growth of that forest, and then have an idea on what is the forest height at a certain point. So just to give you an example of this, this is a satellite image from Sweden here. What we have been looking at here is the amount of clear cuts that has happened and changes that has happened since 95 using historical satellite images. This is not the Sentinel satellites that I just talked about that was launched 2 years ago, 3 years ago now. These are the Landsat images, American satellite data that has been going into this. We have analyzed over 700 images to derive those patches that you see here, where we can take both clear cuts, meaning that you remove all the forest, but we can also look at deforestation and disturbances in the forests, meaning that if there's a lot of thinning going on in the forest and there are patches happening inside the forest where you see that there's something happening, this will be picked up by this kind of analysis also. So once you have that information, it's also possible to sort of forecast or give indication about what will happen. That's more difficult, of course, but it since it depends on a lot of other issues than just forest management. But a lot can be said based on these kind of trends that you see here in terms of what happens in the future also. So there you get sort of the whole profile of what has happened at a site, and you see that there's actually quite a lot of changes. And one of the main points that I want to make is that the information that you normally assess, the input data that you normally assess are taken at one point in time. So we are able to get that whole range of different times and see what has happened and give that as input to the wind resource modeling. So what we also looked at, and this has been the main core of our research together with DTU Space and EMD Investors and Vattenfall and DTU Wind, has been to assess forest height. It's not an easy task, and we have spent quite a lot of time of getting a model, and we now have a forest height that is available for most sites in the world. I've written any sites, but there's still some issues in tropical forests that we have to address. Since there are not that many wind turbines in tropical forests, we have written that this is available for any sites in the world. So the method that we have developed is based on optical and radar satellite imagery. It's also using as calibration and validation height samples from satellite LiDAR missions. This is basically putting a laser on top of a satellite and shooting it down on the ground to get the sample points of what the actual height is. So we put that all into a machine learning model and then get our forest height and density measurements from that model. Basically, it looks like this. We can assess the forest height. Here is a site from Scotland. There are some issues regarding what height is returned. We tend to underestimate the forest height with this model. I think Ebbe will talk about this also, but this is a bias that can be corrected for. I think Ebbe will address this in her evaluation of this. So basically we see the whole structure and the structure of the forest in 10 meter resolution now. And there are other methods to derive forest height, LiDAR campaigns. There are some available satellite method based on different techniques that are both more costly and more timely to get. It takes longer time to get. So this method has, and this is what we have to discuss with all of you, a lot of potential in terms of being a fast method that can get good forest height inputs in a timely manner. So this is what we would like you to test and give us feedback on how you see this can enhance your wind resource model. The forest density is something that we can address also, the so-called leaf area index. This is yet a different model that we have developed in the project also. We would like your feedback on the importance of the forest density also for your site assessments also. So basically, I mentioned a different technique for getting information about forest site also. There is commercially available satellite digital elevation models where you have a surface model and terrain model, and you can subtract those to get some information about forest site also. Those are commercially available. We have those also. They take a bit longer time to produce than the method I've shown you, but they also give good results on forest height and can also, of course, be used for your input where you need the digital terrain models for your wind resource estimation. So basically my conclusions are quite simple. We have now a range of input data on land cover, forest height and density. We can look at historical trends and forecast of sites, and we can provide digital elevation models. And the main point I want to make is that this is timely information. It's up to date, but we can also assess historical changes going back in time. So we are interested to learn, and this is why we engage in this project, how this can improve wind resource modeling. So this is what I have to say right now.
Thank you, Torsten. You did very well in keeping the time. And I think there's time for one or two questions before we move on. Raise your hand or chat in if you have a question.
Yeah, hi, this is Finn. Sorry, I cannot find the button to raise
That's
my
fine.
Hand. One question for me would be that, of course, if we want to use these products, then first it would be interesting to, of course, get the data from when we have the measurement period of the wind data. So we can basically train our model to that, the flow modeling, and then maybe make cases to, okay, how would then the forestry change over time to then assess it like a worst case scenario, basically. So basically question is, okay, how far back in time can you go for these products?
I think for the one I showed you on the forest height, this particular project here on forest height and density, we can go 2 to 3 years back when the Sentinel were launched. But we have also options of using more coarse products and go further back in time, but then the granularity of the pixel will go up. So it will not be as a fine resolution as what you see here.
Thank you very
much. So the historical trend analysis I showed you, this one, those are based on Landsat images that go back to around 85, 90. So there we have the chance to go back to analyze deforestation and trend analysis. So it very much depends on the site also, whether there's good archive data to do the analysis, and that's all the site specific. So I think the easy answer from my side would be that it's site specific. Maybe Rasmus, do you want to add to this, if there's anything I'm missing here?
No, I'll just follow up. Maybe, I mean, Finn, how far back in time are you looking for, ideally?
Well, it's, if we're assessing sites now, then, well, most of the measurement campaigns are maybe 3-4 years ago. So we would, okay, in the moment, look into sites where we might have this issue that we don't have the sentinel data. So the question is, can we still get forest data from that point in time, or do we have to just use, the data how it is today? Which is, of course, then not exactly what was measured in this measurement campaign, right?
Yeah. Well, what we can do is assess changes and then sort of extrapolate backwards using this kind of trend analysis, what I showed you here. So there you would have to sort of use Landsat images to analyze the site, maybe get a forest height model from recent days, and then go back in time to assess how that forest height would have looked at the time that you were interested in. So yes, that is possible, but that requires a bit more detailed analysis than just plug and play, so to say, because you would need to combine the trend analysis that I'm showing you here with an updated forest height model based on the Sentinel. So this is actually something that we are doing for company right now.
Thank you.